Well, good afternoon and welcome to the first of the Ian Ramsey Centre Humane Philosophy Project seminars for Hillary Term 2017 here at the Theology and Religion Faculty at the University of Oxford. These seminars are jointly sponsored by the John Templeton Foundation and also thanks to a grant from the University of Warsaw Faculty of Philosophy. I'm delighted with the talk title for today. It's a topic that I've long been interested in, artificial intelligence and robotics. And I'm also delighted we have such an esteemed speaker. But as my Polish is not quite good enough to do justice to his name, I'm going to leave the introductions to my colleague Mikoy from the Humane Philosophy Project. Thank you very much.
As you already know, I'm more than capable of pronouncing our speaker's name, which is Professor Stanisław Krajewski from the Institute of Philosophy at the University of Warsaw, which is one of the institutions that cooperates with running this series of talks. Professor Krajewski does research in philosophy of mathematics, interreligious dialogue, and Jewish thought as well. He has co-authored the post-war section of the core exhibition in the Museum of the History of Polish Jews in Warsaw, which is well worth visiting, and his books include Gödel's Theorem and its philosophical interpretations, Does Mathematics Belong to the Humanities, and Theology in Mathematics. And the topic of today's lecture is Can a Robot Be Grateful Beyond Logic Towards Religion? So please give a very warm welcome to our speaker this evening.
Thank you, thank you. Thank you very much. I don't need that microphone, I have my own. Thank you also to all those who made this opportunity possible. So let me begin with a more general remark. Namely, it's about philosophy and computers that I'm going to share some of my reflections with you. We know so well that computers are now part of our world and they define our world in a way, in new ways, that is. And my question is, what does it mean for philosophy? And I think for philosophy, whatever could be the other arguments, whether it is good or bad, because there are, of course, reasons to say that it's wonderful and the reasons to say that we should be afraid. But for philosophy, I think, and this is what I want to stress, is that this is a new reality, the presence of computers and robots and all those things, that the philosophy should not ignore. How to take this into account is not clear, but certainly it should be taken into account in the most serious possible way, I think. So one way is to ask the perennial question, namely about the nature of us, of humanity, of human beings, of us humans. And to make it more specific, you know, we can ask whether a robot can be indistinguishable from us. Of course, at the moment, we don't have much trouble with that. But the point is, you know, ultimately, will it be really problem that could cause us troubles? Because at the moment, I guess, we all feel that we are better than computers or than robots, okay? And we hope we will remain better. But better in what sense? After all, the robots can be much stronger, faster, more accurate. The cameras can do much better than our vision. The operations run much faster. They can take into account many more elements at the same time than we can. They can recognize our fingerprints in a fraction of a second, at which we can't, etc. So still, if we are pressed, probably we would say that, well, there are those things like consciousness or self-consciousness or natural language, all those things, of course, very important. Is there a common denominator to all those? I don't know, but one proposal that I like to propose is that we feel that our understanding of the world is better than that of computers. or robots. Robots are computers who pretend they are human, yes? Something like this. So far, of course, we are still much better. But will this remain so? I hope, and I hope you hope too, but why? So this is the problem. When you look at this, you immediately see robots are taller, yes? So computers grew on logic, or logical research, actually. Logic is related to mathematics. So let us see first why mathematics or mathematization makes, you know, what is its contribution to the topic. And first, the negative contribution. That is, there are some reasons to think that mathematics or things connected to mathematics can serve as an argument against the feeling of our superiority or the thesis about our superiority. So one such thesis, one such reasons comes from the fact that scientific description of the world has become more and more mathematical, mathematized, which has provided a sort of vindication for the Platonic and Pythagorean approach to the world. So for modern science, the world consists of special mathematical structures when you think about advanced theoretical physics, for example. And because also space and time are not continuous, so in theory they could be described, those structures, by combinations of numbers, which is a very, very much a Pythagorean picture. And nowadays we have another, even more impressive, practical justification of this Pythagorean approach, namely that digital analysis and simulation of reality have provided direct justification of the thesis that everything is number. A program, any program, can be coded as a one huge number. So computers are unbelievably successful. And in fact, there are some philosophers, as you know, who have taken it so seriously that they say that everything is or could be a computer or an automaton or a program. For example, Stephen Wolfram, a leader in computerization, has claimed that the whole world is just a cellular automaton. Then, of course, we as part of the world would be also the same sort of thing. So essentially, we would certainly be nothing more than computers. This is an extreme version of this approach. Someone has called it cyber totalism. I'm not saying we should agree to it, of course, any more to any other totalitarianism. It remains a philosophical faith. We are not forced by sheer math results to believe in matrix or something like that. Still, because mathematics is used to define our world so heavily, as I mentioned, and the mathematical structures are seen as the core of the, can be seen as the core of the world, of the what the world is. And this and those structures, when physically, from the physical point of view, are essentially finite, then, you know, we would say that in this way science and computers support a new version of naturalism, which can be called a new neo-Pythagorean worldview. At the same time, let's remember, now we're going to the other side of the problem, mathematics involves infinity in a very, very serious way. And this fact alone has been used to oppose naturalism. So let us now begin a series of arguments trying to show the insufficiency of naturalism, and more specifically of our how we can argue for our superiority over robots. Okay. So the first, as I say, is mathematical infinity that really provides an argument. Namely, as we know in mathematics, modern mathematics, infinity is everywhere. It's just the basis of the whole mathematical enterprise. But the very existence of infinite sets or structures is really something that must be assumed. And this assumption is based on nothing but belief. Actually, up to the 19th century, nobody believed there are actually infinite structures or sets. This only was introduced seriously in the 19th century and very soon completely dominated the 20th century mathematics. And of course, infinity is very useful, makes theories fruitful, easier than the restriction to the finite, to the realm of the finite. On the other hand, it seems that maybe it is not necessary to have infinite structures for practical applications. So this belief in infinite sets, however useful they are, is very much like the belief in God, actually. Traditionally, as we all know, there was a distinction between actual infinity and the potential infinity. So pretty much everyone accepted the potential infinity, even if the actual infinity was seen as really non-existent. But even this tame sort of infinity, the potential one, symbolized by the three dots, yes, 1, 2, 3, and so on, can be questioned as being too abstract to really exist. This has been done by a certain philosopher, Brian Rotman, an Englishman, but who works in America, who published a book with a telling title, a quote, Ad Infinitum, The Ghost in Turing's Machine, Taking God Out of Mathematics and Putting the Body Back In. His basic belief is that even the potential infinity of numbers is too much. It's too much of a Platonic and really theological assumption, goes beyond naturalism. So the body should be put back, because the basic philosophical vision of mathematicians is that mathematicians have no body. Nothing in the philosophy of mathematics usually takes seriously into account the fact that mathematicians, human mathematicians, have bodies, so they cannot, for example, go on with any sort of procedure indefinitely. At some point you are too tired or etc. So this is not our today's topic, but the fact is that there can be an idea that of new mathematics here. Still, the fact is that in real life mathematics, we deal with infinity all the time. And at least since Descartes, this alone has been used to show our superiority over machines. It is unclear, though, if mathematics by itself demonstrates the necessity of the existence of something beyond the material, or rather just assumes it. And it's unclear whether our ability to do mathematics shows an infinite element somehow in the nature, in our human nature. But there is a specific and very famous attempt to use mathematics, or logic actually, mathematical logic, to show that we are better than robots. And it is an attempt that is very appropriate for computer enthusiasts, and it is also extremely appropriate for me to mention this argument right here, because in the next building next to us, there are photographs of philosophers of this Department of Philosophy here in Oxford, and one of them is John Lucas, whose name is often associated with this argument, which uses Gödel's theorem, this mathematical theorem about incompleteness. Actually, more recently, it is Roger Penrose, an outstanding mathematician, who is in much more detail developing the same sort of argument. So this argument, the point is whether it does prove our superiority, or, as Lucas probably wanted, the existence of the soul. The argument basically goes as follows. We assume that there is a theorem-proving machine equivalent to human mathematical powers. I mean, a machine, a robot, whose mathematical powers are equivalent to the idealized human ones. And perhaps, let's say, only in the realm of arithmetic, elementary arithmetic. You know. Then the argument goes, the totality of the theorems provable by the machine, by this robot, is either inconsistent, but then it cannot be equivalent to us because we are, of course, consistent, they say, or it is consistent, the totality of the theorems provable by the machine, but then we can see that the Gödel's sentence for this totality is true, but the machine, by Gödel's theorem, cannot prove this, so we are better than the machine. This sort of argument is called out-Gödeling. So why is this insufficient? I think, I'm sure, indeed wrong. Well, of course, to say this with details would take a lot of time, but briefly, it is possible to prove that assuming one's consistency and using the Gödel theorem and any other theorem of that kind to show man's superiority over machines, that those two assumptions together inevitably lead to inconsistency. So it's a very general theory, or not theory, a very general theorem that really shows that both Lucas and Penrose and everyone who tries to use this argument in a systematic way must fall into inconsistency or just into a vicious circle. So it can be demonstrated that every kind of argument in this style is either circular or leads to an inconsistency. This was, by the way, clearly understood by Gödel himself, who said that it is not excluded by his results that, to put it in my way, not his way, that there is a robot whom we can call Luke, equivalent to the human mind as far as mathematical capacities go, and merging in some way. And we can say that it can emerge, for example, as a in result of an evolution among robots or something like that. So what would then happen? You know, we, even if this robot does exist and is equivalent to us in the realm of mathematics, it wouldn't be possible for us to know that because it's too complicated. For a superhuman mind, it could be possible, but not for us or for that robot, for that matter. So, and at the same time, you know, whatever Lucas say or Penrose wants to do or declare, the robot Luke could do the same. So probably at some point, the robot would be tempted to out-Gödel Lucas. So is there a way to save the argument? Because the argument has some power, for sure, and if Penrose is so, you know, for so long trying to say that against the opinion of the logicians, it means something. So my point is, my belief is, yes, there is a way to save it, namely to adopt, as Penrose really does, a natural view of mathematics, which means that to see mathematics as arising from simple self-evident truths by, you know, logical deduction. But without that assumption, the outgödeling does not work. It's not sufficient. So again, why can we do better than robots? Why? So the understanding the world is this is the our focus now, as it has been, but now it is let me do it more like point by point. So first, this Gödelian argument that I just mentioned and criticized does have some other power, merit, that that must be emphasized. Namely, there is really something that comes out from it, namely the fact that we are unable to state a complete set of axioms which would be a full definition of numbers, of natural numbers, 1, 2, 3, etc. At the same time, we do understand the concept of numbers, which means that we are unable to put that understanding into terms that would be possible, that we would be able to put into a program. So we cannot feed our concept of natural numbers into a computer. The issue is subtle. As I mentioned, the robot can exist, which means that there could be a robot. I mean, it's not excluded by Gödel's theorem that there is such a robot, which understands, at least does the same things with numbers as we do, can do the same things with numbers as we can. But we cannot program this. We cannot produce that robot. So it does contribute something, but it's not an argument that really is enough. What are other ways of looking at our superiority? I think one basic way is to look at the issue of context. In virtually all real life situations, context is crucial. To understand what is going on, we take into account the background, which is usually standard, but if not, we notice immediately that this is not a standard background. Only in some purely mathematical situation, context is not important, because we take into account everything that constitutes the situation. Then pure logic is sufficient. Otherwise, we need to assume, that some aspects, some elements are important, relevant, and the others are not relevant. And this is well known. Of course, this is done all the time, especially in science, when we use idealizations, etc. So, but look, to decide which elements of the context are relevant, what is essential and what is secondary, etc., all this requires some value judgments. So this is the best, at least the best I can think of, evidence for the interplay of facts and values against the otherwise attractive idea of the strict separation. And distinguishing between relevant and not relevant is made on the basis of our vision of the world. The vision may be partly implicit, but we need an approach that makes the distinguishing possible. This is just an illustration of this hermeneutical cycle, that some pre-understanding is needed to understand. So, in science, we make idealizations, of course, and we reduce context, although we have to monitor all the time whether the reduction, this truncation is good enough. Can computers do that? In human situations, context means even more than it does in scientific considerations. I would say that in human situation, context is everything. If robots are supposed to act among us humans, they will be handicapped by not being able to detect the context. So there are those assistants, in smartphones, and it happened that this assistant responded to the voice from a TV set when a character in the movie said, "Find me the nearest restaurant." But of course, such problems obviously appear, but they can be overcome. Each specific, properly describable issue of context can probably be somehow incorporated into the program. Can, however, our general ability to take context into account or to ignore it in a meaningful way be simulated by computers? I suspect not. But let us remember that so much can be simulated. And in standard conditions, this can work pretty well. Computers do find the nearest Japanese restaurant, computers drive cars, land aircrafts, etc., etc. In practice, they take into account context in the way that is needed in the standard situation. And they will learn more and more and more. So realistically possible contexts will be stored in the memory or some ways of relating to them will be programmed. So the issue of context, however central it is, may be insufficient to prove our superiority. And further argument would be to consider the natural language. We can speak, and the computer so far can speak only to a very limited extent. I think that the main problem really, which was not understood at the beginning of this, the development of the artificial intelligence, the main problem is, again, context. We speak, and context is obviously present all the time. So in mostly, I think this can be reduced to the previous point. Of course, maybe not quite, but let me leave this at that. What else? The next thing is what I would call personal qualities. It is well known that computers lack emotions, and this is an important deficiency. In fact, computer experts try to redress it, somehow to introduce something like emotions. Perhaps the simulation of emotions can be done, at least to some extent. Then emotions will not be as distinctive as they are now. There is, however, something more. In addition to emotions as such, there are other qualities, like, for example, as it was indicated at the beginning of the debate on computers in the late 60s, early 70s, for example, intentionality, a very philosophical point. I doubt computer scientists work on that. One can argue, however, that we don't need to insert intentionality because it can appear somehow by itself. Can it? Hilary Putnam, who was initially a functionalist, which really, whatever it means, adopted later the view that for the function of intelligence, the whole human being is important, not just his or her program. And evolution, he wrote somewhere, would not give you more intentionality than you put into it. Still, some people can say that intentionality doesn't really exist, so the problem is not there. Or if the complexity is high enough, it will appear automatically. In both cases, robots would do as well as we. There are other human qualities difficult to simulate. For example, imagination or humor. This certainly puts us, our superiority, on more secure ground. But again, can we exclude the prospect of some simulation of those capabilities? And there are more, consciousness of our immortality and things like that. Of course, this all gives more and more, and this leads little by little towards the realm of the religious, as you can see. But computer enthusiasts believe that all those qualities can be either simulated or would emerge somehow. Others are more skeptical. Still, we can look further and see even more of the human issues that are difficult or impossible to simulate. One issue can be, you know, the common denominator would be relations. We live in society, in a community, and our mutual dependence is crucial to being human. Not so with computers. Of course, they do work in networks, the computers. There are groups of computers, etc., working as a team. Yet, if one computer is powerful enough to do the work of all the other ones, it would be sufficient, yes? It's not really necessary to have them relate to each other if there is enough power in one machine. So relations do not seem to be essential to individual computers. So is relationality the way to show our superiority? The issue of relation is something that can be put in a historical perspective. Namely, the history of philosophy can be presented more grammatico. I do this after Jacek Filek from Krakow, a philosopher from Krakow. Namely, to put it very briefly, ancient philosophy, think about Aristotle, was essentially philosophy in the third person. It is, or he, she is. And all the scientific development is in this vein. Also social sciences. Since Descartes, we have the first person philosophy, I am, as the point of departure. And about 100 years ago, the philosophy of dialogue introduced the second person philosophy, you are, as the point of departure. And the basic work in this philosophy of dialogue by Martin Buber says that the I is derived either from the relation I-it or from the relation I-you. But there is no I without relation. I find it quite cogent. I think it is an extension of earlier approaches. And what I want to say now is that this philosophy of dialogue suggests another test of human specificity. Namely, let's try to see what's the furthest possible extension of Turing's test. You know, Turing's test is this famous operational way of checking whether robots can pretend to be in some respects indistinguishable from human beings. The original test is that, you know, questions are asked and answers are given. Well, but let's think about more. As I said, relations are important. So contacts are important. So let's try to think about what are the contacts that are, you know, so specifically human as to, and maybe long-term contacts and cooperation that give us the results which are so strongly human. And the extension going as far as I can imagine is to, you know, bring up. That the robots would bring up other robots. This is something that happens. But the most radical, this is a thought experiment, of course, activity would be to ask the robots to bring up children from birth. I think this is the ultimate toughening of the Turing test, the upbringing of children by robots. So the robots will pass as humans if they are able to bring up children, and so that the children will develop the self, this feeling of I. If the I is, as the philosophy of dialogue says, impossible to develop without the contact with other humans, then those children would not develop the proper feeling of who, of the I, of selfhood. Of course, I know it sounds horrible. It's a thought experiment. I'm not proposing that to anybody to really do that. But it's just to imagine, you know, an experiment that would be the ultimate extension of Turing's test. So to, in a more operational way, the Turing-style proposal would be that, you know, the human being brought up entirely by robots would be, the question is whether it he or she would be indistinguishable or not. So, for example, not if, you know, the you know, in contact with other people during conversation, for example, conversation, they wouldn't be able to tell the whether the person was brought up by humans or by those robots, or during the longer encounter, and ultimately during the relations or the relationship lasting an entire life. Of course, it's so immoral that I hope nobody would ever do it, but it's a way of thinking about those things. And finally, there is another real of issues. Uh-huh. So this is the illustration of my of my proposal. Yes. The last issue is really, you know, our experiences. And this will bring me more directly to the issue of religion. Namely, so there are some feelings, human feelings, that are probably very difficult to simulate, like, you know, being ashamed or being grateful. So let me come back to the title of my talk in a moment. But of course, when we think about those feelings, we think about them as psychological qualities, psychological features. Now, I think there is more than that, at least to some of them. For example, hope. Hope can mean something concrete or be a general attitude, more fundamental than having hope about something specific. So general that it points to something transcending our normal life and our expectations, which really goes into this direction of the religious. Actually, the philosophy of dialogue that I mentioned before has strong religious overtones. Why? Because the relations open for us the realm of the ineffable. For Martin Buber, God is the eternal though. There's a whole theory about this. And to illustrate the point further, let me mention Franz Rosenzweig, a philosopher who, in a very Hegelian language, produced a very anti-Hegelian message. And he wrote basically that, in addition to the traditional ancient organon, mathematics and science, which describes the world, and the organon, which would be, you know, in the present tense, like relating to someone else in the given moment, there is also something that which is in the future tense, namely prayer, yes, prayer, communal, poetic and communal. He was Jewish, so communal prayer was the point of reference to him. Expression of gratefulness and hope, and of hope, and anticipation of something that hopefully can or should come. Prayer, of course, is not just an expression of gratefulness. There is more to prayer. But let me say that, to me personally, this is the most important aspect of it. And this really does bring me to my last point. And this last point is really that when we think about, not prayer, but about being grateful, it can also give us a special proof of God's existence. Now, I know this is rather surprising, and please don't misunderstand me. It's not a naive or mad attempt based on the ignorance of the history. It's of course not a proof. It's rather a proof in quotation marks. What I want to say is that it's a reflection or a meditation on something that comes from experience, which means my experience or experience of those who are others who have similar experiences, which is different from the traditional proofs of God's existence, which are basically assumed to be valid for every rational human being, or maybe every rational being at all. So the question would be, including robots. My proposal is, of course, of a different character. And those who are familiar with the writings of Abraham Joshua Heschel, it should be clear that I owe very much to him. Although this is not exactly what he wrote, no. So sometimes it happens to me, and I presume not just to me, to feel gratitude, which goes beyond gratitude for something concrete or gratitude felt to someone specific. Gratitude as such, simply for my being here, for the world being as it is. However, that fundamental feeling of gratitude extends beyond tangible objects, the world around me. It reaches further and indicates a dimension of gratitude as such. The whole space in which I find myself becomes permeated with gratitude, or rather my gratitude. So to consider it seriously, we should ask the question, whom am I grateful to? Gratitude cannot appear towards objects or impersonal forces, the world, nature, matter, structures, fields, etc. No, a person must be a point of reference here. It's not, however, enough to say that I am grateful to my parents, for example, for my existence, or other ancestors. Of course, I am, but it's more than that. Or to those who organize the society to whom I, as all of us, owe so much, etc. All that would not really refer to that fundamental gratitude, one that cannot be made specific. Whom should I then be grateful to? Who is that person? The person who apparently exists when I feel that, like facing me and my world. Well, not really my world, but the world as such, the whole world. So this person cannot be described or entailed in any categories, but still remains to be one with respect to whom it is proper to feel that fundamental gratitude. So this is this proof in quotation marks, and I think this is a proof or an argument or whatever, a meditation that can really sound, if not convincing, that at least attractive to those who have felt a similar experience. And I hope there are many such people. And I think that no robot belongs to this group. And I guess never will. Thank you.
So Andrew will chair this session, and I'll go around with a roving mic to whoever wants to ask a question. It won't make your voice louder, but it's for the purpose of the recording.
Yes, thank you very much for your talk. I found it very interesting. What do you think of creativity as a test of human specificity?
Of course, it's a good question, creativity is, but to, when we try to begin to define creativity, and I think we'll be in trouble, because I think, you know, in many ways, those computers also can be creative, or at least we can imagine them to be creative in various ways. This, you know, hypothetical robot that is as good in mathematics as we are would be as good in creating mathematics as we are. Whatever it means, of course, it wouldn't be... I'm not saying that such a robot exists. I'm just saying it's not excluded by mathematics alone that such robots could exist. And, you know, of course, there is nothing much I can say about this, but I think creativity is not so simple, because we don't have a good definition of creativity. We feel it very well, of course. We feel what it is, but it's probably not enough.
Yes, I wonder. You ended just by rather taking it for granted that robots can't be grateful, but why couldn't a robot be grateful to the person or people who programmed it and made it? I mean, what stops a computer or a robot actually feeling some kind of response to such people?
Except by definition.
So what would that really mean? Of course, any robot can be programmed to say, I'm grateful to you, John, or Bob, or whatever, but what that would really mean. I mean, how would you define in a more operational way what gratefulness? Because we all feel, know what it means to be grateful. I try to relate to that general gratefulness, unspecific one. Yeah. It's an assumption, yeah, I agree, it's an assumption.
I mean, could a robot, for instance, be willing to sacrifice itself for the sake of the people who made it?
For sure.
I mean, this can be programmed easily, I think. Wouldn't it?
Is it gratitude?
Well, I mean, this is the problem. I mean, what I just want to avoid is just defining it in such a way that, no, a computer can't be grateful. I mean, I wonder what it... I mean, I intuitively agree with you, just as I think that a computer can't understand things. I mean, you at one point you talked about understanding, and you said you said, well, that means that it can do the same things with the numbers we do. But I still feel a computer doesn't understand. It's been programmed to operate in particular ways. I still think there's something missing. And the same with gratitude. But of course, a lot of people would deny that.
Yeah, I agree with you, of course, and this was my point too. Yes. So the computer experts, the artificial intelligence experts would say, no, they, you know, there is nothing much to understanding, you know. If they can do the same, it means they understand the same way. Of course, I agree that I don't think it's true. But with this, perhaps, you know, if they can do something like we do, then okay, they have achieved something. Can they achieve even a minimal gratefulness? How would that be manifested? I mean, I don't know.
Life is built up from the molecular level. So if robots can arrive at something like our consciousness and so on, perhaps this will be possible only when it's built up from a molecular level. And if that's so, then it seems to me that you've arrived at a point in which, I mean, you just, we're almost the same as us, and so they have everything. Yes, but it's just like having a human being create another human being in a natural way. So I just feel that you talk about the last analysis of becoming robots. I think the last analysis will be something built up like us, and that we're able to do that, perhaps. God maybe has given us the capacity.
I think that's something that all those artificial intelligence people try to take into account now. They say that, yes, individual history is important for each of us, and maybe it should be somehow implemented into the world of the robots, that they also would have individual history and so individual memory. That's one thing. Whether the molecules are important here, essential here, I don't know. Of course, to be really human, yes, but to have those human qualities, I don't know. It's unclear. Perhaps yes, perhaps so, but That's another assumption, I guess. But can robots be done from molecules? Maybe they can. Still, probably not the natural way, I guess.
Why did you select gratitude and not some other type of emotion? Like, why not anger? Why not love?
Well, of course, other emotions can be also used the same way, probably, but I wanted to get to this last proof, and this is based, it is based on gratitude, and that's why I wanted to have gratitude as the distinguished quality, but of course you can do this with the other ones too, but I don't see how, you know, other emotions could work to give the proof. That's basically the reason.
Thank you. I'm not sure whether I'll be able to articulate what it is I want to say, but I'll have a go. It strikes me that whether we choose gratitude or, you know, ask other questions, can a robot feel guilt? The crux of it seems to me, and I say this to stress, I am a layperson, so, you know, maybe other people who know a lot more than I do have thought about this and come up with answers. But it's the crux of it to me seems to be to do with the fact that we, as far as I know, no one, no psychologist, no philosopher, no neuroscientist is anywhere near understanding how we experience those things. So I just think we have to be very cautious in stating or guessing or speculating about what computers or robots will or won't be able to do in the future, not least, and I'm stating the obvious here, but sometimes the obvious is worth stating, you know, it's very, very early days. You know, it's fine to speculate, but anyone who thinks they know where robots will be in 50 years' time, let alone 500 or 5,000 years' time, is either very arrogant or very foolish or both. So, you know, I mean, my gut feeling, I think probably like a lot of humans, I don't like the idea almost in some sense that robots will ever completely be able to genuinely duplicate those very human qualities, whether it's gratitude or love or guilt or whatever. But I just think we have to be very, very careful about, you know, the fact that we don't understand at the moment how they can be operationalized. To me, I think we have to tread carefully. I guess that's what I'm saying. I'm probably stating the obvious there. But that's the crux of it. I think it's very much tied up with consciousness, what consciousness really is. You know, who is it that's doing the experiencing? I mean, even with human beings, who or what is it that's feeling gratitude? There are people who deny some people don't believe there's such thing as a self. But if there is a self, what is it? Will robots ever be able to have a self? Anyway, I'll shut up, but I think you get the point. I think these are fascinating questions, but that to me is the crux of what this is all about.
Well, thank you. I certainly agree, yes, and I tried to indicate some of those dimensions that we can consider, but I agree with you that, and I tried to be as modest, so to say, as possible, and not to pretend that the robots will not be something this or that, because they probably can be more and more, we can be more and more efficient in devising better and better robots, or the robots themselves can develop, etc. But I agree. The fact that we don't know how those feelings or attitudes work for us is true. At the same time, we know very well what it means to be ashamed or to be grateful or whatever, or to be in love. Doesn't mean we can, even if we know it very well from inside, doesn't mean we can simulate it, because to simulate it, we need to somehow objectify it and to express it in terms that can be put somewhere in some other, matter. But of course not. But can those qualities develop by themselves or in some other way? So this is this debate about. This is about what the debate is. You know, the AI people say that all those things can develop or can be somehow reached by other ways. There is nothing specific to us. So I think to all those of us who feel that it would be really horrible to have those robots so good, better than us, we have to try to find the ways to indicate those aspects where we can feel or we can hope to remain better.
Thank you. That was my question. But I had another one anyway, which is referring to an earlier step in your argument, which related to the soul and using the soul as a differentiator, I think, if I understood you rightly. Why the soul and not the spirit, especially as some aspects of the soul could be implementable in a machine fashion, whereas that would be, in my view, much more challenging or impossible to do that for the spirit?
Well, I haven't used the term spirit. I have used the term soul only once by trying to say what Lucas wanted to prove, namely that mathematical theorem somehow proves the existence of the soul in some sense. But I didn't use it for myself, myself, to, because I don't think it's clear enough. I'm not saying that there are no souls, but I don't think it's clear enough to use in such arguments.
Yeah. So thank you for your talk. My question was bouncing off a few of these. So earlier someone mentioned that if you have someone, or you build a robot that functionally it acts as if it's grateful, so it sacrifices its life, and you said, no, that's not gratefulness. So, it's not just the function that defines gratefulness, it's the subjective character of the experience. So my question was, would you consider your thesis more of an iteration that it's impossible to provide kind of a physicalist explanation for the mind, if that makes sense? So for the mind, or the mind. So because it seems more like you're saying that, okay, a robot could never be grateful because we could never program it to experience that way, if that makes sense. Because that makes me think of arguments from like Thomas Nagel and philosophers of mind who have given similar ones. So,
of course, I don't know if we can't program. I just hope we can't. The one of the reasons is for the hope. I mean, or the grounds for the hope is that gratefulness is so difficult to define. You know, it is something. I don't even imagine how we can begin with trying to implement it. But I don't know. Maybe there are some people who do it. I think this is probably one of the hardest things to do. Love, maybe love, like is an attraction. You know, things like that. It can. So perhaps somehow be simulated, but gratitude, I don't know. If there is anyone who knows or who tries to do that, that would be very interesting.
Yes, I do have one question about the use of the term simulation to define the problem. I mean, it seems to me that it's very unsurprising that computers tend to simulate human ways of interacting with the world, because that's what we need them for. We need them to function in the contexts in which we ourselves function. So I think to borrow a term from Chalmers, I think the question of whether computers can simulate the things that we find most intimately human is the easy problem in a way. Maybe they can, but it will still be a simulation. I think the real problem, the hard problem, is whether computers might at some point not need to simulate gratitude. I mean, everyone's aware that there are these programs online that you can talk to, and they make it seem like you're talking to a real person. And I've tried a couple of these. It's a lot of fun. And the range of expression that you have as a living person on a live chat is so narrow that the simulation is very, very convincing. You can write a program that will do it very, very convincingly. I think the problem about the development of computers is whether they'll reach a point at which it won't be a simulation anymore. I think that's the worry about our interaction with computers, perhaps on a moral level at some point.
That's true. In fact, probably it does refer in a way to the problem of creativity, which was the first question asked. Yes, but if those computers, you know, develop proper, you know, sufficiently, they may be doing new things, things that were never, you know, imagined by the programmers, who created them. So in this sense, those new things would be not simulating, but doing something on their own. I mean, I agree, simulation is not the same as the real thing, but it, for many practical purposes, it may be basically the same, really. In many ways, you know, very often we, you know, it's like, you know, with there are those tofu can be converted into a steak, yes, which looks, you know, looks like a steak and feels like a steak, and tastes like a steak. It's not a steak, but, you know, in some ways, it's almost the same thing. So the question is, why is simulation good enough? I agree. This is a big problem. But I think that, you know, if someone can pretend to have human qualities, it's already an unbelievable achievement. So that's why all those Turing style tests are interesting.
Well, thank you very much. My first philosophy book was called What Computers Still Can't Do by Herbert Dreyfuss. And I was very impressed that it had been published in the early 1970s.
72, yes.
and then republished about the year 2000, and nothing had much changed. And Herbert Dreyfuss, who's spoken to the Ian Ramsey Center, by the way, about a year ago now, he was very striking in the examples he uses. He takes very, very simple cases and shows how difficult it is for a computer to make sense of simple cases, like a phrase like, I'm at home. How would you mathematicize that, and so on. So over those 30 years or so, nothing seemed to have changed that much. Though the technology had advanced, the conceptual problems had not really seemed to advance. But do you see any advance, really? Genuine advance, as opposed to, if you like, the sort of fancy...
Technical,
yes, that sort of side of things.
So I'm not an expert in those things, even though I have spoken about them, but I'm not an expert on the development of computers and what the people do it, who work on that, do at the moment. I think it's very interesting that, yes, that he already was able to show intentionality, by the way, was, if not mentioned by him, at least inspired, his book inspired me to talk about, to mention an intentionality here at this occasion. Yes, but of course those computers can do so much more and more that we can really imagine easily now the situation when there will be talking with those robots almost like with humans in very specific only realms. I mean, asking to... For example, of course, when we have a cash machine, yes, how do you say ATM in America? They say it, yes. So it's so we can, ask all the problems that are between me and the ATM are really can be solved easily, and the conversation can go on with no problems. So in limited frameworks, I think it can work very, very well.
I'd just like to ask one follow-up question, because I think this is part of the nub of the problem. You can create a micro-world, which is fully a complete set of rules, and it's fine. You can actually copy. You can have a detailed enough set of instructions, like playing chess, like an ATM, and so on. The human ability seems to be to step outside the micro-worlds. I'll give you an example. So if you start a sequence of multiplications, like 1 times 1 is 1, 1 times 2 is 2, 1 times 3 is 3, 1 times 4 is 4, the computer can run forever, never get tired, never stop. But the human being says, this is a crazy game, right? 1 times n is n, where n is anything, game over. I want to now make a cup of tea. So its ability to step outside the micro world, which is part of this extraordinary cognitive power we have, how can we make progress there? How are we likely to make progress, do you think?
Perhaps in this specific case, probably the progress can be made, but in general, I agree. Yes, this is exactly the point. The micro world is the world in which the context is completely clear. It may be maybe thousands or millions of cases, but still it's completely defined. That's the point, really. This was my point with the context, actually.
Ian, we talked about subjectivity. And our experience of subjectivity is our own personal subjectivity. But people who are very close to animals also sense that there is subjectivity among cats, their cat and their dog. So there's some way of seeing or inferring subjectivity in other living beings. Might that then be possible with robots? In other words, instead of saying that it declares that it has subjectivity, from its performance, this kind of almost mystical thing of subjectivity, might it be possible to see it in a computer or a robot which has at last achieved subjectivity?
Some artificial intelligence people say it is possible. They say, that we can have a map or a vision of the world and somehow with myself in it, and this can be somehow defined and put into the computer. So the computer would say, this is the world, I am inside it, this is me. They try to do this. Is it possible to do it successfully? I don't know. I hope not, but I don't know. Okay. That's it.
Well, thank you to our speaker and for a very rich set of questions for us to go away and think about. We're very, very grateful for your time and contribution to us today. Would you please join with me in thanking our speaker.